Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wizardry Quested by Rick Cook. Narrated by Joe Hempel. Part 1. Queen of the Fair. 1. Winter Fair. It was high winter, and beyond the town the world lay under a blanket of white. Wiz and Moira stood outside the outer gate of the castle and looked down the long, sloping high street to the scene beyond.
Oh, Wiz, look at the fresh snow. Isn't it beautiful?
If you say so, Wiz Zumwalt told his wife. I'm a California boy, and this isn't my style.
Oh, you just don't like snow.
It's not that I don't like snow, but I hate slush.
Still, Moira said firmly, it's beautiful.
Wiz reached out and circled her waist with his arm. You're beautiful. Even an objective observer, which Wiz most definitely was not, would have agreed. Moira was wearing a heavy cloak of dark green wool lined and trimmed with dark fur. Her red hair, sparkled by diamond drops of melted snowflakes, hung down over the collar. The cold brought roses to her pale cheeks, and her green eyes were bright under lashes the color of brushed copper. He had loved her from the first moment he had seen her, but that had been a magic spell. What had grown between them since then needed no spells. She clung to him for an instant and then broke away.
Oh, come on, she said breathlessly. I want to see my domain.
Wiz sketched a mock bow. Lead on, Your Majesty. Moira struck a regal pose. Not until tomorrow. After our coronation, you may address us as Your Majesty. Meanwhile, you may give us your arm. Ever since the fair committee had announced its choice, it had been a joke between them. When the fair officially opened tomorrow, Moira would be crowned with holly and mistletoe and proclaimed Winter Queen to reign over the fair. Normally, the queen was one of the women of the town. But this year the townsfolk had chosen Moira. If the truth be known, this was due to a deadlock between the two logical candidates, but Wiz and Moira had chosen to ignore the politics and concentrate on the honor.
What?
You don't want the rest of me? Moira opened her green eyes wide and gave him one of her patented 10,000-volt looks.
There are other parts of you that are useful, she said, but let us leave that for later.
Side by side, they started down the icy street toward the fair. The wizard's keep stood on a great bluff that jutted up at the joining of two rivers. The town known simply as the Capital trailed down the sloping back of the rock to the flatlands below. From where they stood, they could see over the roofs and walls of the Capital down to the fairgrounds. 2 days ago, the water meadows beside the rivers had been as plain and white as the fields beyond. Now, as if by magic, a city had sprung up. Brightly colored canopies spilled carelessly against the fields of white. Along the dark river, boats lay ashore. Here and there, campfires burned against the midwinter's chill, and everywhere people bustled like ants, erecting tents and stalls, unloading and setting up to display their wares. Merchants had come from all over the human lands to trade at the winter fair. Wizards, townsfolk, farmers, and villagers for miles around came to buy, barter, gossip, and just gawk at the spectacle.
Have you ever seen the like? Moira asked excitedly.
In my world, we call them trade shows, Wiz said. Remind me to tell you about comdex sometime. Side by side, they strolled down the capital's main street, greeting townsfolk and acknowledging greetings. Thanks to his magic, Wiz was a member of the Council of the North, the wizards who ruled and watched over the human lands. With his combination of magic and computer programming, he was perhaps the mightiest of the mighty who sat upon the council. But most of the hellos were for Moira. Before they met, she had been a hedge witch in a village near the borders of the Wildwood, sharing the lives of the villagers, healing, advising, and helping them in their day-to-day concerns. Her magical ability would never be above moderate, but she had a warmth and genuine liking for people that none of the mighty could match. There were few enough folk out as they made their way down the cobbled street,
The cold kept as many who could stay inside, and as it was mid-morning, most of the residents were hard at work. Wiz could hear the ring of a blacksmith's anvil carried from some side street in the frosty air. From another street came the steady, rhythmic clanging of a coppersmith beating out a vessel on a stake. The women of the capital liked to do their marketing early, and anyone who had free time and didn't mind the cold would be down at the water meadows watching the fair go up. Wiz and Moira were perhaps halfway through the town when Moira slowed and clutched Wiz's arm more tightly. Wiz turned to look at her and saw she had gone white, making her freckles stand out starkly against her skin. "Darling, are you all right?" "Fine," Moira gasped. "Be fine. Just let me sit for a minute." Wiz guided his wife to a wooden bench by a nearby doorstep. She sank down on it and leaned forward until her head was nearly between her knees. She gasped for breath a couple of times and then held the air in. Wiz stood with his hand on her shoulder, feeling helpless. "Can you make it back all right?" "I do not want to go back," Moira said, staring at her toes. "I will be all right, and we can go on." "Nuts, you're going back to the castle." Moira breathed deeply again and straightened up. Wiz could see the color coming back to her cheeks. "I'm fine," she said in a stronger voice. "It was just a momentary dizziness." "You're trying to do too much, and you know you haven't been feeling well. You need to slow down, or at least let Bronwyn have a look at you." She smiled up at him and patted his hand. "I will. After the fair, I promise." Wiz started to protest, then smiled back. "Why is it I never seem to win these arguments?" Moira's smile grew even brighter, and she squeezed his hand in hers. "Because I am always right." Cold. Black, bitter, eternal cold, and forever frozen silence. They lay heaped where they fell, as they would lie until the primal forces of weather and earth moved them. Some had lived once. Others had lived never. Immaterial. Now the living were as lifeless as the never-living, all mixed together in the dark and endless freezing cold. Somewhere in the chill mass, a thing stirred. As they got lower into town, more people appeared on the street, all going in the same direction. By the time they reached the main gate at the foot of the bluff, they were part of a small crowd. The fair started just outside the gate. The road was lined with a double row of booths and pavilions in various stages of erection. Behind those rows, Wiz could glimpse other tents, all brightly colored, all erected without the least regard for the appearance of their neighbors, yet all of them swirling together into an oddly harmonious whole. The place was a cheerful babble of excited voices chattering, calling, crying wares, and shouting. Here there was a cheer as a pavilion was raised to its full height, followed immediately by a groan as the center pole slipped on the frozen earth and the tent billowed to the ground again. There, children chased one another between the tents and through the crowds, shrieking their excitement. Over yonder, a horse whinnied and a bull bellowed. Somewhere else, musicians played on pipe and drum and tambourine. From the riverbank came the chant of boatmen pulling in unison to bring then boat to shore. The frosty air was rich with the smell of roasting chestnuts and mulled-spiced wine. It smelled of horses and people, garlic and new leather, of faraway places and pine smoke. It was a wonderful odor, and Wiz drank it in eagerly as they let the crowd carry them along. Ice film strained and cracked from motion where no motion should be. Another jerk, and another, and another until the ice flaked away from what had once been a human hand. The skeletal fingers convulsed and tightened to form a parody of a fist.
"Wiz, look out!"
Moira's words brought him out of his reverie as her hand on his bicep guided him away from a large and uninviting mud puddle. Every morning, fresh straw and tan bark was spread to keep mud from fairgoers' boots, but in short order it was trampled, crushed and dragged into the slushy dirt. Moira's eyes were laughing. "I believe the expression is, Wake up and die right? Sorry, he mumbled. I got distracted. Moira's smile and resigned sigh told him she was all too familiar with her husband's absent-mindedness. Looking at her like that, he was reminded once again of how much he loved her. Let's go check out the jeweler's row, he suggested. Perhaps they'll have something fit for a queen. Moira inclined her head regally. Very well. You may precede us to guard us from the mud. Rocks shifted. Clods of frozen earth fell free, and the once living sat erect in his icy grave. The misshapen head turned neither right nor left, but the eyelids lifted on still frozen eyeballs. Moving in uncoordinated jerks and broad swipes, it began to clear the rest of the rubble from its form. A massive wound left the brain half exposed to the freezing air, but scraps and shards began to return. Of true consciousness there was none, nor soul, nor spirit, nor coherent memories. But there were reflexes and skills learned long and well at very fundamental levels. For the animating intelligence, that was sufficient. There was snow drifted against the windows, but the room in the wizard's keep was warm and cozy. A wood fire crackled and danced in the stone fireplace, perfuming the air with cedar. With its carved furniture of dark oak, stone walls, and diamond-paned windows, the place looked positively medieval. With its overflowing litter of scrolls, wooden tables, and a large crystal ball on a stand, it looked like a magician's study. With the letters of glowing fire hanging above the two occupied work tables, the remains of sandwiches beneath the displays, the pot of industrial-strength tea in a corner, and the flowcharts scrawled in charcoal on one whitewashed wall, it looked like a programmer's workroom. In fact, it was both, and the effect managed to be oddly harmonious in spite of the contrasts. Wiz's desk was deserted, but Danny and Jerry were hard at work. Actually, Danny was surfing the internet and Jerry was just doodling, but they were both doing it with the fierce concentration which is the hallmark of a good programmer and the bane of a good programmer's significant other. Going to the fair tomorrow? The younger, slighter man asked over his shoulder when he reached a pausing place. Jerry Andrews shrugged his massive shoulders. He was a big man, and if he was somewhat soft, he was definitely not fat. I don't know. I hadn't really thought about it. Danny spun his chair around and grinned. That's the advantage of having lads. You gotta think about things like the fair. I'm not sure I see that as an advantage, Jerry said slowly. If Malkin were here, I'm sure she'd want to go, he paused. But then that's why Malkin's not here. It's bad enough having to return the stuff she's lifted and make explanations here and in town. At the fair, he shuddered. Yeah, at least June keeps Ian out of trouble rather than encouraging him. Just wait until you have kids. That may be quite a wait, Jerry said dryly. Malkin and I have talked about it and we're not sure we will. Danny just smirked. Oh, speaking of kids, Jerry said, take a look at this, will you? Danny got up and crossed over to look at the work on Jerry's screen, actually a glowing rectangle of fiery letters floating in the air above his desk. It's something kind of silly, really, Jerry went on, but I wanted to see what would happen. Anyway, Ian's birthday's coming up and I thought maybe I could adapt it into something for him. Danny frowned. It's a screensaver. Here, let me. Jerry gestured with the mouse, clicked twice, producing two squeaks from the rodent-like demon, and sat back. After a few seconds, a fluffy, pink, mechanical rabbit wearing sunglasses and beating a bass drum marched back and forth through the lines of code. Pretty neat, Danny agreed, watching the bunny rub out the letters with its passage. Then the rabbit hopped down off the work table and made for the door, still banging his drum. It was out the door and down the corridor before either programmer could react. It had almost reached the corner when Jerry reached the door and gestured at the runaway bunny. It disappeared with a soft pop. I didn't expect that. Yeah, it just kept going and going and... Jerry shot his colleague a dirty look. You and Wiz. Sorry, it was too good to pass up. Anyway, you're gonna need a way to keep that rabbit within bounds. Jerry rubbed his chin thoughtfully. I've got just the solution. The frozen thing tottered erect. Now the half-crushed head swiveled left and right in a ghastly parody of a hunting dog seeking a scent. Finding what it sought, it jerked and stumbled off down an unlit corridor, half-choked with rubble. The fair would not open officially until tomorrow morning, but many of the booths were set up and operating. It was already possible to buy things from the early arriving merchants, and Moira managed quite a regal progress, except when she forgot herself and gave way to bright-eyed excitement. Wiz wished he was walking beside her to watch, but it was faster pushing through the throng single file. They were barely 3/4 of the way along the main way when someone came up behind them. Wiz turned and saw Malice, one of his fellow members of the Council of the North. Besides the staff of a wizard and the blue robe of the mighty, the pudgy wizard also wore the green sash of a fair warden. He was not young and not light, and the combination of age and the effort to catch up with them had him red-faced and puffing. How's it going, Malice? Malice sketched a bow to the pair of them.
Ah, good morrow, my lord, my lady. Well enough, well enough.
He paused to wipe a film of sweat from his bald pate.
Someone tried to set up a trained dragon show down by the corrals. Horses cannot stand the smell, you know, and it just would not have been suitable. Not suitable at all, but we have him on the other side of the grounds now. Oh, and when your turn comes, keep a close eye on Mother Cherisong's booth, the tawdry orange and green one, you know? She swears not, but I think some of her love charms have compulsion spells on them. Not that I could find any, you understand, but I have my suspicions.
Oh, Mother Cherisong's not a bad sort, Moira said. She used to come through my village every year or two. She frowned slightly. She's not malicious at all, but I think she is a bit of a romantic, and the idea of instant undying love would appeal to her.
I'll keep an eye on her, Wiz promised.
Anything else?
It was Malice's turn to frown.
Well, I was not going to mention it just now, but since you ask, I am having a little problem with one of the spells in the new magic. To brighten and dim magical lights, you know. The demon is not doing what it is supposed to. I've been over and over the code, and I can't seem to find the problem. Do you suppose you...
I'd be happy to. I'll be back at the castle in a couple of day-tenths. Could you bring it by then?
Thank you, my lord. 2 day-tenths it is. Enjoy the fair. Good day, my lady.
With that, he wandered off. Moira looked after him, eyes sparkling with laughter. He is a dear, isn't he? Yeah, but I wish he was a little more logical when it comes to programming. Moira shrugged. It was an old discussion. While anyone could use a spell written with Wiz's magic compiler, creating them required the same knack for logical thinking and organization it takes to be a programmer in any language. Traditional magic did not build up spells a statement at a time, and so relied on other qualities, notably memory, intuition, and courage. It was hard to be good at both the old and new magics, and as one of the mighty and a member of the Council of the North, Malice was very good at the traditional magic. He has an eye for chicanery, though, Moira said. Perhaps I had better have a word with Mother Cherisong before you or one of the other fair wardens has to take official notice. At least one journeyman wizard was always on duty among those overseeing the fair to guard against magical trickery. It was not required that the mighty take a turn as fair wardens, still less that the members of the council do so, but many of them did. Want me to come along? It would be best if you escorted me there and then went off on another errand while Mother Cherisong and I talked of old times. Thus implying a threat without having to make it, Wiz nodded. Moira's green eyes grew wide and innocent.
Why no, my lord. How can you think I would threaten a poor old woman? We will merely have a quiet gossip.
Wiz put his arm around his wife's waist. Which will make the point without having to say a word. Darling, did I ever tell you you are brilliant? Moira cocked a burnished copper eyebrow. Only by comparison.
Hey, Danny, Jerry called. Watch this.
2 mouse clicks, 2 mouse squeaks, and the rabbit with the bass drum was back on Jerry's desk. It marched up and down, beating the drum and getting closer to the table's edge with each pass. As the rabbit reached the edge of the table, a green tentacle curled out of the screen, wrapped around the rabbit's throat and jerked it back into the system, cutting the rabbit off in mid-beat.
Crude, Danny said, but effective.
Deep in the wildwood, the sun was also shining. The weak winter rays slanted through the multi-paned windows of the great hall at Heart's Ease, throwing diamond-shaped patterns on the table. 2 women stood beside it, studying a curiously carved casket. Both of them were tall and slender, but the younger one with raven-dark hair was slightly taller than the older woman with the prematurely white hair.
Now watch closely, Chiara the Silver said to her pupil.
Working by touch, because she was blind, she selected a lockpick from the assortment that lay on the table.
You must keep the tension on the mechanism, she said as she smoothly manipulated the lock.
2 hands, one silver-white and the other black with russet highlights, bent over the chest.
Past the first ward, then past the second ward.
Malkin, sometime thief on dragon marches and now Lady to Jerry Andrews of the Wizard's Keep, nodded.
And then the tumbler slips like so, Chiara said. Now you try it.
Malkin bent to it with a will. In seconds, the lock clicked, and the dark-haired woman straightened up in triumph. Then her face froze. Her eyes widened, her features contorted, and she let out a thunderous sneeze.
Had it been real, the blow tube would have been filled with something more lethal than pepper, Chiara said mildly.
You didn't say anything about that, Malkin protested, sneezing again.
The silver-haired woman smiled.
The lesson is never to trust a lock or the person who tells you how to pick it.
Malkin grunted.
Well, that is enough for now, Chiara told her pupil. Your fingers are getting stiff from the cold, and it is best we rest for a bit.
I can go on, Malkin said stubbornly.
The older woman put her hand on the younger one's shoulder.
Of course you can, but there is no need, and it is best not to force such things without need. Now come and have some hot spiced cider.
How did you know? Malkin asked as they settled into high-backed chairs before the fire in the great fireplace.
Chiara said into her mug. About your fingers? Why, I could hear them. You were slowing down on simple operations.
If Chiara was blind, she still had her ears, her hands, her brains, and her memories. Malkin was in the presence of a master burglar, and she knew it. She used no magic, of course. Although Chiara had been a sorceress of high skill, the accident that had ended her career as the council's master thief had left her so sensitive to magic that its very presence hurt her. That was why she lived in a magically dead zone, deep in the wildwood, away from other people and their everyday magics. It was why Heart's Ease itself, from stone tower to attached hall to outbuildings to surrounding stockade, had been built completely without resort to magic.
It is kind of you to teach me, lady, Malkin said as she warmed her hands on the mug of fragrant cider. It is my pleasure. There is not much human company here in the wildwood in wintertime.
Although she didn't mention it, Chiara was also doing Wiz a favor. Wiz wanted to get Malkin out of town during the fair. The multitude of booths and merchants was just too tempting for someone of Malkin's proclivities. Calling Malkin a thief was like saying Don Vito Corleone was a little dishonest or Dr. Jekyll had his moody days. Malkin was that rare combination of aptitude, dedication, and intelligence that marks a true adept at any art. In her case, it just happened to be the art of separating people from their property. For Malkin, stealing wasn't just a job, and it was more than an adventure. It was business, pleasure, and a way of life all rolled into one. She was as dedicated to it as a medieval monk was to his calling, a comparison which would have surprised Jerry, considering her distinctively unmonk-like proclivities in other areas.
You have a powerful talent, Chiara went on. In some ways, too much talent.
Malkin made a noncommittal noise and raised the steaming beaker to her lips.
I doubt you have ever been seriously challenged in your skill. So far, you have been able to rely on your natural abilities blindly, without having to learn the other requirements of your calling.
Such as?
Patience, forethought, perhaps a little humility.
Malkin smiled. As you say, I've done well enough.
But will you do well enough if you face something that really tests you?
The younger woman sighed and set the beaker of cider on the table. Like as not, I'll never find out. Little enough opportunity I'm like to have for a great test. Things are much changed from your day, lady.
Indeed they are, Chiara agreed. And very much for the better.
Humans had little magic in those not-so-long-gone days when Chiara the Silver and her mate, Cormac the Golden, had plied their trade. The pair had relied more on stealth and cunning than Cormac's skill with a sword or Chiara's abilities as a wizardess to purloin especially dangerous pieces of magic for the Council of the North. It had been the last of these quests which had cost Cormac his life and left Chiara blind and allergic to magic of any kind.
Still, you should strive to perfect your art. And be careful what you wish for, the blind woman thought, for you may get it.
Hey, Danny, I've got a new wrinkle for the screensaver. Take a look. Two quick mouse clicks and the bunny appeared. This time the rabbit didn't have its drum. Instead, it was wearing crossed bandoliers and carrying what looked like the mother of all assault weapons. Its pink ears poked out of folds and a camouflage scarf tied around its head pirate fashion.
Uh-oh, Danny said. This looks serious.
As the rabbit approached the edge of the desk, the green tentacle reached out to grab it. The rabbit whirled and ripped off a burst with its machine gun slash grenade launcher. Chunks of tentacle and ichor flew everywhere, and most of the screen disintegrated under the force of the blast. Danny and Jerry dived under the table and nearly butted heads. Suddenly, it was quiet again. The room reeked of powder smoke and plaster dust, but there was no more shooting. Danny sneaked a peek over the edge of the table. There was nothing left on the screen but an occasional letter or two. The pink bunny in the boonie rag blew the smoke from the end of the gun barrel, surveyed the damage, hopped down off the table, and disappeared out the door. Danny crawled the rest of the way out from under the table.
What did you call that thing again?
Jerry coughed and brushed the dust off his tunic as he stood up.
A screensaver?
Well, it didn't save it. It blew it all to hell.
Yeah, I guess it needs a little more work.
Danny could only nod. 2. Foulness at the fair. Almost at the end of the fair's main row, as far from the wizard's keep as possible, a smoke artist was displaying his illusions. The open-fronted booth was carefully darkened to show off his creations to best advantage and, Wiz suspected, to hide the mirrors and other apparatus that made them possible. There were 5 or 6 people clustered in rapt attention before the booth, oblivious to the fairgoers pushing past them. The artist was small and slender, dressed in a cowled black robe obviously meant to remind his audience of a wizard. For an instant, Wiz wondered if it was a man or a woman, but then the artist withdrew an unmistakably masculine hand from the sleeve of his robe to gesture. At the hand motion, 3 gouts of gaily colored smoke blossomed within the booth, billowing toward the cloth, veiling and swirling together in a pattern that seemed to pulsate and dance to an unheard melody. Garnet red and peacock blue smoke combined to form a deep, vibrant purple while tendrils of yellow smoke lanced through the cloud. Then the smoke sorted themselves into layers of pure color and began to interweave monochromatic tendrils in an increasingly complex design. At first it reminded Wiz of a simple geometric shape. Then it became an ever more elaborate piece of Celtic knotwork. Finally, the smokes twisted into a design that seemed completely random, yet hinted at an underlying order. It seemed to Wiz that if he could just study the writhing smokes long enough, he could unlock that secret. Wiz had no real ability to sense magic as this world's wizards could, but he understood the basic laws of physics, and this smoke was behaving in a decidedly lawless manner. There was something wrong here, and the realization sent a chill through him. It took the better part of an hour for servants under Danny's direction to get the workroom cleaned up and presentable again. It took about as long for Jerry to track down and de-instantiate his fluffy pink creation. By the time they had settled down to work again, Jerry had decided to shelve his screensaver, and Danny had gotten a bright idea of his own. "Somehow," Jerry said, surveying the freshly patched plaster and the dusted and neatened up piles of manuscripts, "I don't think that was one of my better ideas." "Oh, I don't know," Danny said. "It gave me an idea for something I've been working on." This time Danny gestured with his mouse, and an aquarium sprang into being on his desk. It was almost as big as the desk and full of water and life. "Like it? It's Ian's birthday present." Jerry examined his companion's work more closely. Against a backdrop of coral and rocks, brightly colored fish darted or hovered or swam lazily, according to their nature. Equally brightly colored crabs and other things crawled along the white coral sand, and here and there something like a sea anemone waved delicately in the water. It was beautiful, but there was something about the setup that bothered Jerry. Part of it, he decided, was that he didn't recognize any of the fish. Then a black angelfish with pulsing neon blue lights along its side swam by, and Jerry's suspicions were confirmed. "Those aren't real fish, are they?" "No, they're demons created by special little programs." Danny spoke a word, and the spell listed itself out in bright letters beside the tank. "Look, here's something else, too. The code's self-modifying, so the fish change over time."
"They change over time?"
"Yeah, they evolve with each generation."
"Hmm," Jerry said in a voice that wasn't at all approving. "What's the matter?"
"I'm not sure," Jerry said.
"But there's something about that notion that bothers me."
"You don't like fish?"
"No, I... Well, never mind. I'm sure Ian will love it."
Jerry turned away from the demon fish tank and back to work. As the smoke artist took a bow to a pattering of applause, Wiz nudged Moira.
"That stuff's magic," he muttered.
"But isn't it lovely? See how it sparkles."
Wiz looked sideways at his wife. Normally, Moira was more wary of strange magic than he was. She had learned about magic at a time when the humans of this world were nearly powerless, and magic was usually destructive or hostile. Wiz had changed that with his magic programming, but the old attitudes lingered. This wasn't at all like her. He looked at the robed and cowled figure again, trying to discern what was beneath the flow of dark cloth. Again, the smoke artist's hands darted from his sleeves, and he began anew with a delicate curl of blue smoke from his outstretched palm. Although Wiz could not see the artist's head, much less his eyes, he got the strong impression that the performer was concentrating on his audience rather than his illusion. The smoke thickened and deepened until there was a column of sapphire blue before him. The crowd pressed close, eager for the next display. Again, the smoke shifted and formed a pattern, this one like an intricately fretted snowflake. The tendrils of blue smoke twisted and wove among each other into a pattern that implied something without quite showing it. As Wiz watched, the pattern began to spin like a wheel, pulling the eye with it in a way that made Wiz's stomach roil. He stared down at his boots, fighting dizziness. As he looked away, he felt Moira stir beside him, pressing closer to the artist and his creation. Without thinking, Wiz put a hand on her shoulder, but she shook it off impatiently. Wiz looked up and saw his wife slack-jawed, with her eyes fixed on the smoke. She took a hesitant step toward it and then a stronger one. "Moira?" There was no response.
"Hey!"
he shouted at the smoke artist, but neither artist nor audience paid the slightest attention. Wiz went cold with fear and almost instantly hot with rage. In two strides, he crossed the distance to the artist and grabbed him by the hood. As he jerked him around, the hood fell back and Wiz recoiled at what was beneath it. His face was normal enough,
pale with high cheekbones and a long nose, but the eyes were not. Instead of showing a normal white and pupil, they were iridescent, as though there were an opaline mist over the whole eyeball, or like an insect's eye when the light strikes it right. The illusionist hissed like a frightened snake and wrenched away from Wiz. His hand darted out of his sleeve, and instinctively Wiz twisted away so the hand struck his wizard staff instead of his arm. There was a flash of blue lightning and a report like a rifle shot as magic met magic. That seemed to break his hold on the crowd, and suddenly people were running and screaming, stampeding away from the booth. Wiz stumbled back, his staff held before him. From down the row of booths came a shout and a flash of magic. Out of the corner of his eye, Wiz saw Malice raise his staff to launch another attack. The thing looked at Malice, back at Wiz and over Wiz's shoulder where Moira was standing. Without a word, it whirled, gathering up the hem of its robe. Black smoke reeking of brimstone poured from the robe and rose in a whirlwind above Wiz's head. Malice fired another magic bolt at the growing black cloud, but it disappeared into the smoke without a trace. Tall as a tree, the black cloud grew, and the wind of its turning whipped and tore at the booths and the robes of the wizards. Then the cloud separated from the earth and darted into the sky, pursued by magical bolts from Malice and lightning bolts hurled by Wiz. It climbed faster and faster until it was no larger than a hand, then a finger, then it moved away to the south.
"What? Who?"
Malice came rushing up, oblivious to the commotion spreading throughout the fair. Then he seemed to realize he would not get answers to his questions and settled for indignation.
"To think that they would try it here. Of all places, why the sheer effrontery of it?"
Wiz noticed he didn't specify who they were.
"Get help," Moira said tightly. "Quickly."
Her words brought Wiz and Malice back to themselves, and both fumbled for the communications crystals they wore around their necks.
"Are you all right?" Wiz asked his wife.
"I think so." She clung to him fiercely and let out a deep breath. "It was like being pulled along by a strong current or sliding down a slope of loose earth.
Before she could continue, there was a soft pop of displaced air, and Ariane, Balsimba's assistant, appeared before them. Ariane's eyes were unfocused and her lips moved silently as she spoke to the communications crystal about her neck. Off behind her, Wiz could see a flight of three dragons soaring away from their cavern area in the cliffs below the wizard's keep. The watchers had launched a ready patrol.
"We sensed a flare of magic even before your call," she told the two wizards. "Now, what was this all about?"
"I don't know," Wiz said, "but I don't like it."
"A magical invasion of the fair," Malice added. "A creature posing as a man."
Moira was pale and shaking.
"It was magic indeed, like no magic I have ever felt before."
"Programmer magic?" Ariane asked. Moira bit her lip.
"Not exactly. Something like it, but different. Colder. Does that make any sense?"
Since Wiz lacked the natural talent needed to sense magic of any sort, he could only nod. He had heard his kind of magic described as feeling like a horde of ants as the tiny spells that made up the words of the magic programming language operated, but he'd never felt it. Ariane, however, had.
"Colder?"
Moira hesitated.
"Not cold, exactly. Rather, not alive."
Wiz had an image of zombie army ants. He didn't like the picture at all. So whatever that thing was, it had a special attraction for people who are sensitive to magic, Wiz summed up. Around the table in the programmer's office, Jerry, Danny, Balsimba, and Ariane all listened intently. After more than an hour's rehashing of events, Moira wasn't paying much attention.
"Which explains why it didn't affect you," Danny put in. "Like the rest of us, you haven't got any magical talent to speak of."
"But Moira probably had more than anyone else in the crowd, so it really worked on her."
"All it did was make me dizzy," Wiz added. Moira looked down at her hands and said nothing.
"None of the other mighty have ever seen or heard of the like," Ariane told them. "This is something completely new, Worse, the magic is so different we did not detect it until the sparrow confronted the thing.
Where did it come from? Jerry asked.
It arrived at the fairgrounds early this morning and set up its pavilion like any other merchant or entertainer, Ariane said. None of the other merchants had ever seen the thing before, but none took special notice of it until the whirlwind began. It so well concealed its nature that Malice walked by the booth several times without seeing anything amiss. She nodded at Wiz and Moira. He apologizes most abjectly for not discovering it sooner.
I cannot blame him, Moira said weakly.
This thing is also, Wiz added, immune to lightning bolts and whatever spell Malice was throwing at it. But we still don't know what it is or what it was after.
We can hazard a guess on the last, I think, rumbled Balsimba from his oversized chair at the head of the table.
Although he had been physically present for the whole conference, he had spent most of it receiving reports and communing magically with others of the mighty.
An attack? Ariane asked.
More likely a scout, the great black wizard said slowly. Something sent ahead to spy us out and discover our defenses.
So you don't think it was alone?
It seems unlikely. What we know now seems to suggest a being controlled or commanded from elsewhere, not an independent entity.
Any idea who or where?
Balsimba shrugged.
That is as yet unknown. Perhaps we can discover more when the Council of the North meets this evening. He heaved himself erect. Now, if you will excuse me, I must consult directly with the Watchers. My lords, my ladies. He sketched a bow and left.
Are you sure you're all right? Do you want to go lie down?
No, I'm fine.
You don't look it, Danny put in. You're white as a sheet and you look awful.
Moira looked up. A fine thing to tell a woman, I am sure.
Well, you do, Danny said defensively.
Perhaps you'd better go lie down, darling. You really don't look well.
Moira reached out and patted Wiz's hand.
Perhaps I will. Dealing with strange magic seems to take a lot out of me.
Well, came a female voice from the door. All alive, I see.
Wiz looked up and saw a stout woman standing at the door. A boy and girl were peeking around her from either side, and a dragon was looking over her shoulder.
Oh, hello, Shauna, Wiz said.
Any reason why we shouldn't be?
Shauna was nurse to Ian, Danny and June's son, and mother of Ian's playmate, Caitlin. In addition to looking after the children and mothering June as needed, she provided a strong dose of common sense for the programming team.
Fortuna, but you should hear the stories being bandied about in the town.
She looked over at Moira.
Do you know you and Wiz both are dead a dozen times over? And each death grislier than the last?
In spite of himself, Wiz grinned. And there are a dozen eyewitnesses to each death, no doubt. He took a pull on his mug of tea.
Folks are bolting their doors strong tonight,
the stocky woman agreed.
Fact is, I've never seen them so frightened. It'll put a damper on this year's fair, I'll tell you.
Moira stood up suddenly.
Then I am going back to the fair.
Wiz spewed tea all over the table.
What?
Moira reached for her cloak.
I said I am going back. The people need reassurance.
You're sick and you're going to bed.
People need my help and I am well enough for that.
Wiz started to protest. Realized this was another one of those arguments he wasn't going to win, and changed course.
Then I'm going with you, he said grimly. How much reassurance is there if I am in the company of the mightiest wizard of the North? No, if this is to be effective, you must not come.
Look, we don't know what that thing was or what it can do. I'm not going to let you go down there alone.
Moira put her cloak down on the table and turned to face him.
That thing is gone. And what happens if you nearly pass out like you did this morning?
That'll be a lot of reassurance for everyone.
I will manage.
You'll manage better with the proper company, my lady, Shauna said, looking closely at Moira.
No, not you, she added before Wiz could open his mouth. I'm the one to go with her.
Wiz had the feeling he'd just missed something important, and an even stronger feeling that the situation was getting out of control.
Still, I'm not sure it's safe.
As safe as anywhere, Moira retorted.
Ariane nodded. Three of the mighty have examined the rest of the fair and found nothing more. This thing harmed no one, and I have alerted the watchers in the castle. With them on guard, it will not be able to sneak close again. Meanwhile, Balsimba has summoned the Council of the North to meet to consider what more is to be done.
Besides, Fluffy will protect us, Ian said.
Wiz raised his eyebrows and looked past the boy at the 20-foot dragon standing behind him. The dragon's tongue was lolling out, and he was panting like a particularly dumb dog. Fluffy was a very young dragon, hardly older than Ian. Like all immature dragons, he was not very smart. But unlike most of them, he was more or less a house pet, a circumstance that aroused considerable comment in the wizard's keep, and even more among the townsfolk. Fluffy had attached himself to the programmers as a house cat-sized hatchling. When Ian was born, the two became inseparable. Originally, the programmers had called him Little Red Dragon, or LRD for short. But Ian insisted his name was Fluffy, and wildly inappropriate as the moniker was, it stuck. If there was trouble, the dragon was only likely to make it worse. But separating Ian and Fluffy made them both mope, so if Ian went to the fair, it was a foregone conclusion that Fluffy was going too. The prospect did nothing to raise Wiz's enthusiasm for the expedition. Danny, meanwhile, had grasped the critical point.
Us? He demanded of his son. Who said anything about you going? Shauna's going, Ian said. You always said we should stay close to Shauna, especially if there's trouble.
While Danny was at a loss over the 8-year-old's logic, Shauna's daughter saw her opportunity and moved in for the kill. Caitlin was a couple of years older than Ian, with a mop of jet black hair, apple cheeks, and great dark eyes. She had her PhD in cute, with advanced graduate work in wheedling.
We want to go to the fair, Caitlin protested.
Danny tried for a compromise.
You can go to the fair tomorrow when it's open.
Tomorrow's too late, Ian protested. Everything will be up by then.
Wiz wasn't sure why it was more interesting to watch the booths go up than to see them once they were up and open, but that was clearly the general opinion. Even Fluffy managed to droop sadly at what he'd be missing.
All right, then I'm going too, Danny said. You would be almost as bad as Wiz, Moira told him. You had best stay here as well.
June stood close behind her son with a hand on his shoulder.
I go too.
Which figured, since June was as protective of Ian as a mother tiger is of her cub. Danny looked over at June and Ian and scowled, but he nodded.
Well, all right, but you stay close, you hear?
And then, as Caitlin and Ian cheered, Shauna added,
and keep that creature on the leash.
Ian had obviously been anticipating victory because he had the dragon's collar and braided leather leash tucked in his belt. Fluffy drooped his head so Ian could attach his collar. In fact, the leash was strictly for show. Fluffy wouldn't allow anyone but Ian to lead him, and there was no way the boy could have held the dragon against his will. As it was, Fluffy had a tendency to jerk Ian off his feet with a casual toss of his head. But the sight of the leash made townsfolk slightly more comfortable around the dragon, and Fluffy seemed to understand that the leash meant he was to be on his best behavior. Besides, Ian was inordinately proud of his job controlling Fluffy.
Okay, Wiz said to his wife. You won't take me, and you won't take Danny.
What about Jerry?
Moira raised an eyebrow and looked over at Ariane. The tall woman stroked her chin and thought.
Appropriate enough, she said finally.
I don't know, the big programmer demurred. I've got this homicidal screensaver I'm working on.
Caitlin tugged on his arm and looked up at him with enormous dark eyes.
Please, Uncle Jerry, it won't be any fun without you. Please come.
Jerry suddenly found he was not at all immune to the wiles of a little girl. In fact, like most men without children of their own, he could be twisted around a tiny pinky almost without effort.
Sure, he sighed. I'll go back with you. That way the lads can see what's going on.
Wiz looked down at the dark stain of spilled tea on his shirt. Well, darling, he sighed, at least keep your eyes open and yell at the first sign of trouble. I think that thing was after you. Ariane looked at him closely. Can you be sure it is aimed at Moira? I don't like the way it looked at her. You said it seemed to be surveying the crowd. Yeah, but... Wiz lapsed into an unhappy silence. Oh, don't brood, love, Moira said. It is perfectly safe, and I will have Jerry with me should need arise.
Plus two lads, Wiz added. There was an insistent woof over his shoulder. And a dragon.
Shauna and June will be along as well, Moira countered. That carried some weight, Wiz had to admit. Shauna could keep the kids under control, and June was likely to be at least some help. Danny's wife was strange and half-wild from growing up in an elf hill, but she was no one to trifle with. On one memorable occasion, Wiz had seen her take out three fully armed hobgoblins with the knife she always carried.
Well, I still don't like it.
Moira reached out and put her hand on his arm. Pooh, you heard Ariane. There is no danger now, but the townsfolk must be reassured, so it needs to be done.
We've got to do something about this Calvinist sense of duty of yours, Wiz said as Moira picked up her cloak.
Who is Calvin?
He designed jeans, Wiz said absently, and he gave you the heavy-duty kind.
Moira did what she usually did when she didn't understand her husband, which was to change the subject. You're a fine one to talk about duty. All a dragon has to do is show up and make some threats, and you go off with him, and we don't hear from you for weeks.
That was different, Wiz said with some dignity, hoping reverently Moira wouldn't ask him how it was different.
She settled for cocking a coppery eyebrow and fastening the cloak at her throat. Then, seeing his expression, Moira reached out and took his hand. Please, Wiz.
Wiz hesitated and then relented. As long as it's safe. She kissed him on the cheek.
Oh, we'll be fine, she told him. You worry too much.
Far and away, in a place below the earth, a thing considered. It was enough. It had found what it needed. Now there was only the harvest.
Danny and Wiz stood at a window and watched the group cross the courtyard and pass out the castle gate.
I guess they're right, Wiz said, as much for his own reassurance as Danny's. It's perfectly safe, he sighed. I wonder if I'm getting paranoid in my old age.
I know I'm paranoid, Danny said grimly. I just don't know if I'm paranoid enough.
3. The fair again. The fair was very different in the afternoon than it had been that morning. Intermittent clouds hid the sun, and the air that had been crisp and invigorating in the morning was now chill and damp. Even the mud seemed deeper, all of which could have been her imagination, Moira admitted. But there were other changes which clearly were not. The crowds of gawkers were gone, leaving only the fair workers, merchants, and here and there a knot of guardsmen armed and alert. There was less shouting and no laughter as people struggled to get their goods unloaded and their tents up, none of which mattered to the children. Ian and Caitlin went whooping and shouting among the booths, avoiding most of the uninteresting mud puddles and seeming to be everywhere at once. Fluffy trotted along with them, head high like a show dog in the ring. Shauna puffed along behind, calling out admonishments and generally trying to keep them under control. June floated along near Ian, close and silent as always. It would have been a perfectly normal scene, Moira thought, if June didn't keep one hand always on her knife. She dug Jerry in the ribs with her elbow. Smile, she commanded out of the side of her mouth. Then, putting on her best beauty pageant smile, she and Jerry began to stroll among the booths. Moira paused frequently to admire goods on display or to chat with someone she knew. Jerry contented himself with smiling until his jaw ached and responding to any pleasantries directed to him.
Ian and Caitlin were disappointed at the pace, especially since June and Shauna would not let them get too far ahead of the others. Still, they managed to find all sorts of interesting things to look at and interesting questions to ask. They even cajoled a chestnut vendor into blowing up his fire to roast some nuts for them. They'd gone perhaps halfway down the main aisle when Seamus, the captain of the castle's guard, separated himself from a knot of his men and came over to greet them. "A pleasure to see you, my lady," he said loudly as he smiled and bowed. His eyes never stopped moving. Moira nodded to the guard captain. "Good afternoon, Seamus," she said equally loudly. "Oh, I would not have missed it." The guardsman took her hand as if to kiss it and used that as an excuse to move closer. "Thanks for coming," he muttered. "The whole place is nervous as a bunch of half-wild dragons. Want an escort?" Moira dimpled as if she had.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.